Well, we're continuing our studies in the series, Ask the Exiles. This is study 36, would you believe? And in the book of Nehemiah, it's study 11. Still looking at the personal journeys of these exiled Jews, and we're doing so through questions. Questions, of course, are directed at ourselves, but we have been finding the answers in the lives of those we are studying. So a reminder of just the ones, the questions we've used and the record that Nehemiah brings so far, and they have been these. Am I concerned about God's glory? Is my influence positive or negative? Am I a team player? Do I need to be reminded of the bigger picture? Have I got stickability? Am I a giver or a getter? Am I being lured by the enemy? What have I done with joy? Why is it important to remember God's faithfulness? And last week's study was around this question, have I kept my vows? So in that study, we reminded ourselves that the returned exiles pledged themselves to obedience. In fact, they went a step further. They put their oath in writing and they signed their names to it. Very serious thing to do, isn't that right? They also accepted in writing that they would expose themselves to any curse that would proceed from their failure to keep their vows. That's serious stuff. And we concluded our study with a number of texts, but this was the one that was most appropriate. Ecclesiastes 5 and 5. Better it is that thou shouldst not vow than that thou shouldst vow and not pay. So we're moving on, and this week's question is this. Am I able to see an end as a beginning? Am I able to see an end as a beginning? We're in Nehemiah 11, and we'll read from the first verse. Nehemiah chapter 11 and verse 1. And the rulers of the people dwelt at Jerusalem. The rest of the people cast lots to bring one tenth to dwell in Jerusalem, the holy city, and nine parts to dwell in other cities. And the people blessed all the men that willingly offered themselves to dwell at Jerusalem. And I think we have two categories of people here, just stopping at that second verse. Those who willingly left their homes in the countryside and answered the call to settle within the city walls that have just been rebuilt. That's one group. And those who drew the short straw, we might say. Lots were cast and it fell on a certain number. And one tenth left their homes in the countryside to come into the city by that method. So two groups of people. And the reason I think they're two distinct groups is that if all of them had willingly come, there would have been no need to cast lots, would there? So, thankfully, some were willing. You know, that puts me in mind of times when a church has prospered and done well and grown, but the area next to where that church is, perhaps a neighbouring town or city, has no church. And a decision is made to plant another assembly in that neighbouring place. The foundational church, if you like, the mother church, and then the daughter fellowship. Now, it's no small thing for people who are in a church that's doing well and has every facility and all the personnel, all the musicians and this team and that ministry and the other ministry. It's no small thing for people to leave all of that and to go and feel led to start up a church plant elsewhere. What do you think about that? Put yourself in that situation. Maybe you've done that. Maybe there's someone here and that has been what you have experienced in the past. Because to go to a new venture as a church plant, well, there's going to be less personnel. You might end up having to do a whole host of things. You might end up having to do almost everything. It's a sacrifice, really. But it's not a sacrifice unless it's done willingly. And of course, sacrifice is not sacrifice unless it costs. You know, the worldly attitudes today that are around us are about how little we can do. Job shares and delegation and everything like that is part of our vocabulary now. It's just the way we are in the 21st century. But it's also crept into the church. In fact, the idea of sacrificial commitment is almost seen as abuse to expect that. Are we willing volunteers in the Lord's work? Are we unwilling conscripts? Or are we non-conscientious objectors? Back to Nehemiah 11, and back to verse 2. The people blessed all that willingly offered themselves to dwell at Jerusalem. That verse made me think too. Were the people who blessed the others, were they maybe already living in Jerusalem? And there they were struggling because, as you know, a watch had to be kept on the city walls. And it was really stretched amongst the people who lived there. So when they would love to have had a few extra people to share the burden, to take up the shift, the night shift. I wonder, were they the ones who blessed them? Oh, bless you. That's going to help us out greatly here. Or were the people who blessed them the ones who had just no intention of offering themselves? Bless you. Because that gets me off the hook. You do it. That'll save me. It's really back to the theme of comfort zones again, isn't it? People who willingly offered themselves had to leave their comfort zone. And they had to go and settle independently of what they had known and start again within the city. What's our question today? Am I able to see an end as a beginning? Those folks who would be leaving the comfort zone of living in the countryside. It would be an end to that way of life. That's what would make them sad. That's what would make it difficult for them to come to that decision. That's where the tug and the pull would be not to go willingly. It would be an end to something. But it makes a massive difference if you don't see it as an end, but as a beginning. I wonder what you're going through in life. Is there something that has happened, something you see as an end of an era? Maybe you're approaching retirement, maybe you're about to get married. Different things, different people, and different parts and different stages of their walk with God and walk in this life. And something is the end of what you've known. And whilst you might lament that, have you ever thought, well, why don't you see it as the beginning of something else? A new chapter. A new experience. A new way in which God can reveal himself to you in all his faithfulness that we've been singing about earlier. Able to do other things through you. To take you on a new adventure. I believe from the cradle to the grave, we have every reason as believers to always expect that God will always do something else with us, through us. Use us. Something new. Am I able to see an end as a beginning? Maybe you've had crushing news about being made redundant or a business venture that you've worked hard to establish and it has to close. Do you see that as an end and that's that? Or do you see that as an end that leads to a new beginning? Well, you know my testimony, don't you? You know how business went under in the financial crash of 2008-2009. But in 2011, I was in the Lord's work. It was an end, but there was a new beginning. We have a wonderful God, haven't we? Am I able to see an end as a beginning? Verse 3 of chapter 11. Now these are the chief of the province that dwelt at Jerusalem. Enter verse 6. All the sons of Perez that dwelt at Jerusalem were 408. Valiant men, note that. Into verse 9, Joel the son of Zichri was their overseer. Judah the son of Sanua was second overseer over the city. So there's a couple more job titles. Verse 10, of the priests, Jedaiah the son of Joiarib, Jachin, Seraiah. And then to the end of the verse, was the ruler of the house of God. So there's another job title, verse 12, and their brethren that did the work of the house. 822, and to verse 14, and their brethren, mighty men of valor, that's another title, 128, and their overseer, so somebody that was over them. And on down through it, we have these different job titles. Then verse 17, and Mataniah, the son of Micah, the son of Zabdi, son of Asaph, was the principal to begin the thanksgiving in prayer. And verse 22, the overseer also of the Levites at Jerusalem was Uzzi, the son of Bani. And verse 23, it was the king's commandment concerning them that a portion should be for the singers. There's another job title, due for every day. So here we have a list of names, yes, but also a list of job titles, a list of ranks. So there's a governor mentioned, there's valiant men, we could say soldiers, guards, caretakers, assistant caretakers, deputy caretakers, if you like, second in command, priests, Levites, porters, singers, musicians. All of these titles are there, and they're there for a reason. And then verse 17 again, and Mataniah was the principal to begin in thanksgiving and prayer. And the mention of giving thanks is prominent in this chapter. Not only have we it there in verse 17, we have it in verse 27, verse 31, verse 38, and verse 40. They have a lot to be thankful for. Because in this former war zone, because that's really what Jerusalem had been, it's like us looking at different parts of Ukraine that have been totally devastated, and there's plenty of other countries in the world where this has happened as well. And we look at the mess and the ruin. Well, that's really what the exiles were going back to, ruin. And now they have this functioning society with all these people fulfilling all of these roles. And they have much to thank God for. They're thanking God for his provision, but it doesn't just stop there. They're also going to make use of God's provision. All these people are going to have a job to do. And they're going to make what God has provided work. So there's an infrastructure in place. Yes, they were instrumental in getting the walls up and getting the gates on and all the rest of that. And some might have said, job done. Isn't that what Nehemiah went back from the palace to do? Said to the king, I want to go and rebuild the walls. They've achieved that. It's looking amazing. It's no longer a disgrace to the neighbouring countries. And that might have been seen as the end of the project. Done it. Sorted. Finished. But what's her question? Am I able to see an end as a beginning? Because it was really a beginning. Now they had what they needed to go forward. When we come into chapter 12, we find yet another list of exiles, and it's again from the first return. And this is how it starts, chapter 12, verse 1. Now these are the priests, the Levites, that went up with Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and Jeshua, Seraiah, Jeremiah, Ezra, and on and on and on it goes. Until we come to verse 27, of chapter 12, where we read this. And at the dedication of the wall of Jerusalem, they sought the Levites out of all their places to bring them to Jerusalem to keep the dedication with gladness, both with thanksgiving, there's that theme again, with singing, with cymbals, psalteries, with harps. And the sons of the singers gathered themselves together, both out of the plain country round about Jerusalem, from the villages as of Netohaphi, that'll do, also from the house of Gilgal, and out of the fields of Geba and Asmaveth, for the singers had builded the villages round about Jerusalem. So, a dedication is planned. A dedication is going to take place. A dedication of the walls. Now, in our English translations of the Bible, the word dedicate is used for two different Hebrew words, one of which means to concentrate, to make holy, to set apart. But the other means to initiate or to mark the beginning of a thing. And the word used here is also the word used in Deuteronomy chapter 20 for a man who builds a house for himself. He plants a vineyard or is about to get married. It's the word about a new beginning, something initiated, something about to commence. And that ties in again with our question. Am I able to see an end as a beginning? So this dedication ceremony wasn't just saying, all done. It was done so that we can do, so that we can do more. The hard work with all its setbacks and all its opposition that we've already looked at, yes, it had come to an end, and the temptation might be to think that that's that. What a relief. They might have said, God gave us this commission, we've done it. They might think that's the chapter closed. But as we've mentioned earlier, unlike some of the novels and books that we read, and biographies and autobiographies, some of you I know just go to the last page to see how it ends at the beginning. But with the work of God in your life and mine, just when you think it's finished, you turn and there's another chapter. And one day when we close our eyes in this life, do you know something? There'll be another chapter. Isn't that amazing? In a different place. God's eternity. Well, the dedication ceremony was going to be a big occasion. We'll see that with the elaborate formalities that were going to take place. And it was going to be a big occasion because a big message had to be sent out. They're open for business. This is no longer that pile of rubble that people would drive past. This is now a city. Working, operating for the glory of God. When we read through the account of the dedication ceremony, there are a few references in there to King David, to King Solomon, to Asaph. It's as if the writer is linking us to other dedications, the dedication of the very first temple, Solomon's temple, centuries earlier. Now, this is a very different situation that we are dealing with here in Nehemiah than the first temple dedication. The walls in the temple are not as grand as Solomon would have built them. But something is the same. This is still a big occasion. This is still a big deal. And this is every bit as solemn an occasion as what happened in Solomon's day. Now, solemnity doesn't mean sadness. Seriousness doesn't mean sadness. Holiness doesn't mean sadness. Reverence doesn't mean sadness. But sometimes we do equate these things. I've met some folk in the past in my walk of life, and I remember a couple. And they were always talking about holiness. Nothing wrong with that. You have holiness is. And they were the kind of people who wouldn't send Christmas cards. And I could give you a whole list of things that they felt were unholy. Yes, these people were real. Now, saved people, sincere people, and all the rest of it. But they had this notion of holiness. But they were two of the most miserable, sad people you ever met. I remember when I would say to my family, I'm going down to see so-and-so. And they might go, oh, they'll help you. was kind of when you come back, the first thing they say, what tale of woe did you get today? And that's their impression of holiness. That's not the holiness I read of in the Bible. Not at all. Because really what holiness means, fundamentally, you'll find it in Jesus. You'll find it in Jesus. And what do we see in Jesus? He always pleased the Father. That's holiness. Not a list of do's and don'ts and this and that. Jesus always pleased the Father. That's holiness. Because he was holy. Well, holiness doesn't have to be sadness. Reverence doesn't have to be sadness. Seriousness doesn't have to be sadness. Solemnity doesn't have to be sadness. There was a weight to this dedication ceremony. But it didn't mean they had to be miserable. This was an important moment, and it was important that it was marked. They are acknowledging that what has happened in the completion of the walls and in God's provision and in the people settling within the city and it being a functioning society, they're acknowledging that God has made this happen. They're acknowledging that this has come from God. Well, how are they going to demonstrate the acknowledgement of the importance of the dedication? Well, verse 30 of Nehemiah 12. The priests and the Levites purified themselves and purified the people and the gates and the wall. Now, if we just read there that they purified themselves, we could have thought of a number of things that the priests might have done. There were ceremonial washing stations, mikvahs. It might have bent up, but you'd have trouble putting the walls into a mikvah and putting the gates into a mikvah. So, and it's the same phrase used for all of these things. So it's the priests, it's the people, it's the gates, and it's the wall. So we're not exactly sure what happened for them to recognize that this purification had taken place. But they felt that it should. Now remember this. One of my favorite pieces of music is The Holy City, isn't it? A wonderful piece of music. Well, Jerusalem was to be the holy city. And that's important. So an act of purification of some kind was appropriate for the dedication of the city. This was a city that had been defiled. This was a city that had been shamed. And yet it was God's holy city. Even the priesthood, if you think about it, those who had returned, they had to forget about their linen priestly garments. And for quite a while, they had to put on a stonemason's apron, hadn't they? They had to build. They had mortar under their fingernails. So there had to come a time when they said, right, that's over. And an act of purification of some kind took place. Now, the passage doesn't tell us exactly what happened, but we know that way back at the beginning of, the commencement of, the initiation of the sacrificial system through the tabernacle in the wilderness, remember all the items that were made? Bronze, silver, gold, all of these items. And on the day when everything was to begin to be used, blood was applied to horns of the altar. Blood was applied to the great toe of Aaron on his right foot and his right ear. And the priests were taken and washed before the linen garment. There was a purification in that sense. There was blood sprinkled on the people and on all the different items and vessels in the tabernacle. So it may have been something along those lines. But that, again, is linking it with something that was about to be used, a beginning. The tabernacle signified the beginning of the sacrificial system. And those things were to be sanctified, in other words, set apart, holy to God, for God's use and God's service. The very walls were God's walls. The city was God's city. The temple was God's temple. The people were God's people. The priesthood was God's priesthood. God had given it all. He had given them the land. He gave them the law. He gave them the covenants. He gave them the prophets. He gave them the opportunity to return. He even gave them favor with pagan kings. He gave the very materials that they needed to rebuild. He gave them the right leaders at the right time. He gave them even the ability, the strength to rebuild. He gave them protection as they rebuilt. This was God's work. He gave the gifts, he gives the abilities, he provided what was needed. And isn't that just how our God works? Hudson Taylor said this, God's work done in God's way will never lack God's supply. Do you believe it? God equips, God enables, God gifts people. But then they must realize that this is just the beginning. And then the work takes another direction and they begin to serve. It wasn't just the act of dedication. The act of dedication was the initiation of everybody being in their God-given role. I remember working with a lady, and in the office, it was all men except for her. And she was cursed, if you know what that means. And if you don't, I'll tell you, her language was blue. Would have made a sailor blush. And the blasphemous term she used about the Saviour was second to none, terrible. She smoked like a train in the days when you could smoke in an office. And she was always talking about the big nights out where she had too much Pernod and white, whatever that is too. But on a Friday, she would come into my office and she would photocopy stuff to teach Sunday school in the Presbyterian Church. And then on one day, she said, what she did was she went to the church hall, taught Sunday school, and then she cleared off home. She didn't even go into the service. And one day, she was moaning, oh, I'll have to go into church this week because the minister wants to pray over all the leaders on the first Sunday in September before the work commences. He wants to... a prayer of dedication. Now, what was the use of that prayer of dedication for that woman? So it's not about an act in itself. It's about what happens within. It's about our service going on. It's about us pleasing God thereafter. Not about an act. There are lots of ceremonies and things take place in churches. Lots of people are prayed over and all kinds of things happen. Commissioning services to this, to that, and the other. But what do we really do? They purified themselves, the people, the gates, and the wall. They were saying to all witnesses, we have served in the construction of this rebuilding. That's over. Now we're going to live our lives in the way that God expects us from this moment onwards. Am I able to see an end as a beginning? Verse 31, Nehemiah 12. Then I brought up the princes of Judah upon the wall and pointed two great companies of them that gave thanks, whereof one went on the right hand upon the wall toward the dung gate, and after them there's a list of people and so on. And really what it describes is the two groups are created. And they both go in two different directions around the perimeter of the wall, on the wall, and then they would meet. It's a parade. They're parading with instruments and with dozens and dozens and dozens of singers. It would be amazing, wouldn't it? I brought them up onto the wall. Now, the city wall was thought to have been about 8 foot wide. At that particular time. So it wasn't like the old walls you see there in Carrickfergus, the old perimeter walls that aren't that thick. It's probably more like what you'd see if you went to Derry's walls, and as many of you have walked around them, you're able to do that. So something along those lines if you want a comparison. But here's something interesting. Do you remember the mockery that came from the surrounding nations in our earlier chapters? Do you remember what they said? If a fox was to go up on top of the work that these Jews are doing. It's so unstable and unprofessional that a wee light fox would topple the whole thing down. Isn't that what they said? You don't remember that? Well, they did. Now Nehemiah is saying, right, get up onto the walls. Armies of a parade. And go right round every last inch. Don't just appear at one strong point. Walk round the whole of the walls and show them that not only could a fox not topple them, but two parades of musicians and singers can't topple the walls either. What a testimony. That's the turnaround. When Nehemiah heard back in the palace the disgrace of the walls being broken down, it broke his heart. And he wanted to get back to do something about it. And now this is the climax. It's done. Let's rejoice. Let's tell the world. Let's rebuild our testimony. I wonder if there's somebody here. And perhaps you've failed the Lord in some way. And you're always living in the shadow of that. And maybe you make a greater deal of that than the Lord does. Because we can make an idol of things, even our failures in our lives. Why not rebuild? Why not start again? And rebuild your testimony. So that people then, looking at what has happened to you in the last 1 year, rather than what happened 20 years ago, will be able to see the hand of God and the work of God. Our God's a restoring God, isn't he? He's one who restores the years the locusts have eaten. Well, the walls of Jerusalem represented a testimony, but it was God's testimony and God's glory. Jesus came into this world, and just after his baptism, what happened next? Straight out into the temptation in the wilderness, isn't that right? And there he was tempted of the devil. Why did that happen? Was it to see if Jesus might fail and might sin? Was that what that was all about? No, it was to show that he couldn't. It wasn't to see if he might, it was to show he couldn't. I remember an illustration being given of an engineering project. It was a massive flyover road, like Spaghetti Junction. And this new section, this flyover had been built, and all the engineers had been involved, and they knew before they started to build it that it would hold all the vehicles that it should hold. But there came a day when they piled every lorry that they could get onto it at the one time. There's no way those engineers waited until that day to see if their calculations were right. Wouldn't that be ridiculous? Because what if it collapsed? But the reason they put all the vehicles onto the flyover on that day was to show to the world that it couldn't collapse. Do you see the difference? Why was Jesus tempted in the wilderness? Not to see if he might give in, but to show that he couldn't give in. To show that he is our great conqueror. And that's why through him we can be more than conquerors through Christ who loved us. Are you glad you're on the side of victory? Doesn't mean to say we're always victorious, but we could be. We could be. Because Jesus is our victor and he's victorious. Verse 37, at the fountain gate, which is over against them, they went up by the stairs of the city, going up of the wall, and the other company of them, verse 38, gave thanks. Verse 40, then stood the two companies that gave thanks. And on it goes. And verse 41, the priests, Eliakim, Maaseiah, Menahem, and on down through a list of names there. They had trumpets, and they sang aloud in verse 42. And then verse 43, they offered that day great sacrifices and rejoiced, for God made them rejoice with great joy. The wives also and the children rejoiced, so that the joy of Jerusalem, get this, was heard afar off. Isn't that wonderful? That's a sanctified sound, isn't it? That's so unlike the sound that reached the ears of God when he was on Mount Sinai in those very holy, holy moments when it was burning like fire and Moses was afraid to look up and the receiving of the law. And what's happening at the bottom of the mountain? There's a party. A disgusting party. Dancing around a golden calf. That's an awful noise, isn't it, to hear? I think of the noise that Samuel heard whenever he was about to meet Saul, who had come back from fighting with the Amalekites. And what does he hear? He hears the bleating of sheep. These are sounds that are the complete opposite of this, because those are sounds of disobedience. Here's a sound of obedience. Here's a sound of people pleasing God. And you know something? That's the kind of testimony that'll go places. You know, your testimony might go places that you'll never go. There are people who have written books, books that have impressed me, inspired me, recordings that I've heard in my young Christian life that have inspired me, people I will never meet, but their testimony has gone farther than they ever will. And the joy of Jerusalem was heard even afar off. What kind of sound are we sending out from this assembly? What are people saying about Monkstown? Well, we had talked about how the singers, because they've come up quite a lot through the book of Nehemiah, haven't they? I've mentioned them many, many times. They were neglected and this and that and the other. They got their back in and they worked and all that. And we mentioned at one point, they had all their voices, they had all their music, but they had no bookings. Well, now they've got a whopper of a booking, haven't they? It came around. You know, maybe you're thinking to yourself, I know the Lord has impressed this upon me and he's given me that ability and that gift. But I don't seem to ever have any avenues to use that. Just wait. Just wait. Your day to go around the walls might come. So what's our question today? Am I able to see an end as a beginning? Maybe you came here today and all you were focused on was the end. Leave here thinking about the beginning. And may the Lord bless these thoughts to all of our hearts for his name's sake.